Hey everybody, this episode of Ars Decoded is brought to you in part by No Wave Academy. No Wave Academy provides online instructional workshops from some of today's best fine artists. Some of the artists include Mia Bergeron, Paul Christina, Nick Runke, Daniel Seagrove, John Wentz, and many more. A lot of these artists have actually been featured on Ars Decoded as well, so definitely go check out the archive to check those out. The Academy recently released an Oil Painting from Life workshop with master oil painter Sean Cheatham. Artist Decoded is offering 10% off of all of their online workshops, so please go to nowaveacademy.com, type in AD-10 at checkout for 10% off. Now, on to the episode. Hey everyone, how's it going? This is your host Yoshino, and you're listening to episode number 156. And in this episode, I get the opportunity to talk to artist based out of Amsterdam, Daan Noppen, who mainly works in the mediums of drawing and painting, but he's also best known for his realistic, larger-than-life drawings of portraits and bodies in conjunction with geometric elements. His attraction to physics in relation to our being and our emotions plays a big part in his overall body of work. He plays with this notion of reality by projecting time as a physical dimension. Rather than becoming something clinically scientific, he opens up a visual world with hidden layers alluding to our desires, pain, and need to be loved. I had a really fascinating conversation with him. We talk about his origin story within the arts. We also talk about the subject of breaking down of traditional gender roles, and we touch upon his recent residency with Andrew Salgado at his studio in London, which played a very significant role in the way that he perceives his work and the direction of his work now and in the future. So before we begin this episode, I'd like to give a shout out to our sponsors over at Savoir Faire. And we appreciate the continued support of Savoir Faire, who are importers of fine art materials for the arts. And for nearly 40 years, Savoir Faire has been working to bring the finest art and stationery supplies the world has to offer to American artists from brands including Sennelier, Fabriano Paper, Isabey Brushes, and many more. Every product line they represent has been chosen either for long-standing tradition as a premier manufacturer, or as an interesting newcomer with innovative products and ideas. If you'd like to get more information on their products, go follow them at Art Savoir Faire on IG and Facebook. So before we begin this episode, please go to our iTunes page and leave us a review. It helps reviewers just like yourself to hear about this podcast. It also helps us to be able to obtain new sponsors and new people to collaborate with for the podcast, so it would be greatly appreciated if you can do that. So here it is, without further ado, my conversation with artist Daan Noppen. Hope you enjoy it. Thanks so much for being on Artist Decoded, man. I really appreciate you for taking the time, and I'm glad that our mutual friend John Wentz was able to put us in touch. And thanks for doing it.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It's a real honor. I've been listening to your podcast quite a while. And so many great artists on there. So I was honored to be asked. So thanks a lot for being here.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, no problem. I'm glad that you listen to the podcast as well.
Yeah, it's big inspiration. And funny enough, like now it's like inviting other people in your room, you know, because I built this little studio in my home so I could just keep on working and you don't see anybody, right? So listening to a podcast while I'm painting, it's like having some people in the room with you or something. I don't know. So it's super nice. Yeah.
I think the medium of podcasting, maybe it's just because it's audible and I don't know. There's something interesting about having a conversation just between two people, and it's almost feels more intimate in a way, because what I was noticing is that I just started experimenting with doing IG live videos, and doing like a conversation like this over IG live, I feel like you're more aware of the element of an audience as opposed to just having a conversation like this, because it's almost like we're just having a phone conversation almost.
Yeah, totally.
I guess, yeah, to kind of jump into it. I mean, I have a lot of questions for you, but so I want to start off with a very simple question. Why art?
Yeah. I sort of grew to that slowly because I started with applied arts. So I studied design first, did a lot of graphic design and through photography and film. At some point just decided that I wanted to do free work. Also because I really found out that a lot of my work was pretty dark and it just didn't fit applied art in the sense, you know, you have to sell something or a commercial message. I don't know, the aesthetics sort of started to collide. So it was also necessary, but I felt the urge to discover that.
So what got you into art in the first place?
I think I've always been pulled to it. And I was very fortunate, like my parents were pretty open to, you know, you as a person and what you want to do in life. So my dad dragged me to art academies to see what it was like and if it would be something for me. So I do remember I think I was probably about 4 years old or something. And my mother had this huge roll of wallpaper, white wallpaper, and she just stuck it on the wall all around the room. So it was basically, you know, my height, the width of the roll. So I just went, and she just let me draw all around on the walls. Maybe that was something that triggered it. I don't know. I just remember always being drawing or painting or something like it.
So then what made you want to get into the applied arts, you know, going from drawing and painting in your adolescence and, you know, as a child, and then going into taking it on as a career? And you said that you were, did you study graphic design in university, or was that like a more generalized art degree?
It was in university, and it was kind of, but it was more like factored in certain departments. And when I started out, I had this really naive idea that I wanted to become a car designer. It sounded really great to me. And then I found out that, I don't know, you could be designing 6 or 8 months, like designing one rim or one wheel or something, you know. So that wasn't so glamorous in the end for me. But that was a complete disillusion, but in a good way, I guess, because I started out in that department. It was called mobility. And then I switched to more like an interior design department. And I remember there was basically only women studying there at the time. So it was not really a thing for guys to do at the time, I guess. But I learned so much. And it was also kind of like something I started doing more, where it's like when you feel something is in a non-comfort zone, just so you want to stay away from it, but just go there because there's something for you. And this was definitely one of those things. So I got introduced to a lot of things that I wouldn't have done otherwise. And graphic design naturally came with that for me somehow, because we started designing patterns in that department for furniture. And I just, you know, at that time, Photoshop became a normal thing and Illustrator and all those tools. And I just started trying it out and working with that. So that was not specifically for the department, but I just grabbed that and started applying that to whatever I was doing.
What do you think about just that idea of you going into the interior design department and there not being a lot of other male figures within that program? What do you think during that time in terms of the gender roles, you know, because I think a lot of the sort of cultural zeitgeist right now of thought is around, you know, the breaking down of these gender roles and how there's this huge push towards feminism and also like understanding the balance between like femininity and masculinity within both men and women. Like, what do you think about that now, reflecting on that, you know, being in a program such as that where you're essentially one of maybe a couple of men in that program?
Yeah, if you look at it now from the perspective of what we experience today, and not only the layered part of the discussion, but also those kinds of energies, it almost seems weird. But because I remember the head of the department was taken aback sometimes, because, you know, I guess I brought in different ideas because I just came from a different department. And now that's a normality, you know, get influence comes from so many places or so many different people. But back then it was very structured. It was already like, yeah, so what are you doing here? In a way, it was inspiring, because now it's more like you can, you know, information is so much out there and you cannot not have things mixed. But then it was, I don't know, for me, it was super fresh finding that and getting that influence from different people and with a different energy being it. Yeah, I guess it was more female, definitely. Mm-hmm. So that was also for me finding out my female energy more, which I think it definitely fitted me more. So I was discovering a lot more about myself in that period than the period before. Yeah.
I read this book entitled The Way of the Superior Man, and it's by this author, David Data. Have you read this book?
No, it does sound familiar, but definitely no.
Yeah, it basically breaks down this idea between femininity and masculinity and how it exists in all of us, and to essentially lean in to your natural inclinations, like your natural way of intaking the world, whether that's with a more feminine approach or a more masculine approach. And I think just reading that book, along with just, you know, different philosophies that I personally have about gender roles and the breaking down of gender roles and and things, it was just a really informative book on that subject, especially when I read it during that time in like my late 20s.
It's funny that you mentioned it. I think 2 weeks ago or something, I was watching this really old movie with Humphrey Bogart. I forgot the title, but it's crazy to see that. Yeah.
Why do you think so? Just because of the different time period?
Yeah, and how that was a normal, I guess. Yeah. Yeah, because do you think that's really a cultural thing at the moment? I mean, in the US, obviously, I sense that that's a big topic and it's out there a lot. Do you feel it's very much culturally bound in that sense, or do you think it's a global thing that's...
In terms of gender roles, or in terms of...
Yeah.
I mean, that's like a... it's a really interesting question. I think it has to do a lot with our societies and the way that society functions. So in America, it's like, you know, in school, the educational system has brought us up with these sort of capitalistic ideals and this idea of meritocracy. And, you know, the more that you put into your work, the more that you're going to get out of it. And that sort of like binary thinking that gets ingrained in you at a young age. And I think that's getting broken down as like time progresses. Actually, yeah, it is kind of hard to say if it's more of a cultural thing or if it's more of just like a humanistic thing. I think it's just both mixed in there. But what's your perspective on it?
Yeah, no, I struggle with that question a lot because I don't have the answer to that either. I mean, as a person, I think I have a lot of female energy. I use that in my work as well. And funny enough, I think I depict a lot of women in a very powerful sense, so maybe in a more masculine manner. I'm aware that I play with those energies and that sense of meaning and identity, but it's still a very fluid concept somehow. I don't know, it's not something that I fully grasp.
Yeah, it's just an interesting concept just to think about gender roles and, you know, the sort of like gender fluidity that as artists, and I only use artists as an example because a lot of the times artists are trying to, I mean, I feel like true artists try to relate with the world from a very emotional place and a truthful and honest place. And this is kind of a generalization, but I think at least the artists that I like, it seems like there's this honest thing that they're trying to extrude out from them within their varying medium. But what do you think?
I try that very hard to do that. And I guess people, well, funny, yeah. If I look at John's work, and funny, I was doing a residency in London at the beginning of this year, just before the crazy thing started. And it was in an artist's studio, Andrew Sagato's studio in London. He painter. He invited me to do a residency inside his atelier. And his work is so emotional. And especially, that's why I'm fascinated by his work, especially in the sense of color and texture that he uses by means of his paint. Yeah, it's amazing to see how he works, and also slowly, you know, when you talk to him, to understand how, what his ideas were about it. I took a lot from that.
What do you think you took from it?
I think most of all, confusion. I have to explain it. I think right now I'm in a very, I'm in a big transformation. My work is transforming a lot, and I haven't been really showing that a lot yet, but I mean, my work's pretty realistic. You can see a certain it's not hyper realistic in the sense that I would literally draw a photo or something, but what is depicted is something that's very close to reality, and it's like I opened a few doors and it's like you cannot go back. Not that I want to, because it's super fascinating, but it's also scary and everything, and it's like, what the hell am I doing that stuff? And that's definitely the biggest thing I took away from that, I guess. Yeah. Apart from some really interesting practical things, like when he walks into his studio, he will paint and just focus on that. So he's very clear about walking out of that space, you know, at the end of the day and doing something else. I tend to sometimes be longer in an atelier than he does, but then, you know, shift my attention to something else, to my phone, or, you know, a lot of nonsense. So the focus he makes and the compactness in that sense, you know, just that time that he's there to be so productive. And also by saying, yeah, you know, if I fail on a day and I just come in for 2 or 3 hours, I will go at it, and because they all add up, they all count. So that was important stuff as well. But the other one is definitely the big takeaway. Yeah,
I think it's always good to constantly be willing to intake information and to humble yourself, to be able to learn from someone else, and to not bring in, I mean, it's hard not to bring in like your own experiences into a given situation where you're trying to learn from someone. But I think like allowing yourself to intake and observe and to learn from a non-egotistical sense, I think is very important when it comes to just grasping new information in general. And that's what it sounds like it was for you. Am I right?
Yeah, totally. Also, I was able to let go. I think it was also due to his work is so different than what I do. So, you know, I really jumped in the deep in that sense. There was no way for me to sort of control anyway. So, yeah, it was funny. I was listening to, I think it was the podcast you did with Dana Thompson.
Oh, yeah. Dina. Yeah.
Yeah. Dina. Sorry. Man, I think it was literally the first couple of lines she said of the advice. I was like, man, wow, that was so spot on.
I forget, what did she say? Do you remember?
Yeah, it's literally about that. So you have to, if it's safe or easy, something like that, don't follow it. you really have to go to that uncomfort zone, because there's something for you there. She was even saying that your breakthrough could be there. But those kinds of, she was very clear about how she said it. So she really experienced and owned it. You can hear that when somebody says that, no?
Definitely. The interesting thing about that conversation is she had a lot of very clear advice, but she's also very humbled and curious and is willing to be able to intake new information. So yeah, I don't know. It's I think we all should kind of toggle the line between knowing and not knowing and be okay with that.
Yeah, totally.
But I think a lot of the times, you know, we want to project to other people that, you know, in like a conversation, like if you just meet someone, and it, depending on the setting, but that conversation presents itself a challenge. Like, do I become super vulnerable with this person and then tell them sort of these feelings or things that I've been going through? Or do I tell this person kind of like a inflated version of myself? I think each conversation challenges you, right?
Yeah. And I guess it's a lot to do with confidence, or being, you know, if you're being insecure about certain things that you're going through.
Yeah.
I mean, that's very alive now, no? And basically a lot of people in the world are right now living in a place where they don't know how it's going to go. So yeah, mm-hmm. that makes you vulnerable. Totally. But I wouldn't say I like to be in that space, but I must say it feels ideal to me, because it triggers all those elements that she was also talking about. So you will change or grow, or like you were saying, do something with the information that you do find. There's no safe space that you know, that you own, and that you can just endure endlessly. So being in motion and being that fluid and transformative, I must say that's a state that I really try to look for always. It's funny, I think it's the old story of where you kind of have to fight the dragon before you find the gold, you know? So you're trying to stay away, but if you just keep on going and hold through, you will find something.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's it. It's, you know, what I've gleaned on during this time is just being adaptable to change and to be okay with the fact that the world has changed at a tremendous rate. And whether that's through perception, through the media that exacerbates it, or if it's also a combination of that and the actual changes that are occurring and the changes that are going to come on an economic and global scale are something that are unknown. But what you can do is have confidence and faith that you will make the right decision for yourself during this time, and to be able to adapt during this time. And I think that also just brings me back to your residency with Andrew Salgado. I mean, do you think that going through that process, like, what is the next step for you? Like, what is the thing that you've been gestating and marinating on recently?
It's going a lot more into abstraction, the work, I found out that gave me a lot of freedom. So I was very conscious in my work always about, are things looking right, in the sense of something like perspective, for example. Because I tend to use a lot of geometry almost as a fourth dimension in my work. So it's inspired a lot by science, but I don't mean to let it come across like that. I would rather have it to be like an emotional layer, or at least something that addresses something of the human being and its desires, or so it's part of the narrative. But I tried to totally let go of that, how would I put it right, to control that. So put random marks on a canvas and sort of see how something can grow from that instead of really thinking out how everything's going to be laid out on the canvas or even designed up front. So, and I'm sketching with that a lot, and I'm doing it in very bold colors and even bold paint strokes. So whereas before my work was super refined and fine, now I'm literally using a lot of layers of thick paint to make suggestions of things that I would before very time-consumingly refined to create otherwise, I guess. Yeah.
What do you think has allowed you to step into this different mindset of letting go of the hyper-refinedness of your artwork?
Yeah, I had this conversation with another artist before. The first thing that happened was that I found myself sometimes working on a piece for like a month or 8 weeks, even sometimes the big ones. And I realized I was emotionally attached to the work for a week. And then I found myself struggling to technically finish it. So I guess I ran into a wall there, and we were talking, and Henrik Udalen, and he said, you know, at some point I had the same, and I just decided, okay, I'm just going to try to make a work in a week then, you know, or maybe 2 weeks. And he said, like, I think I failed miserably in the beginning, but slowly I managed to create stuff that I really loved again. And I was like, man, why didn't I think of that, you know? But I started doing that. I think that was the first thing. And then that freedom that I was just talking about, that was definitely the second part. I have this big library of images and pictures of objects that I found over the years that I felt I wanted to do something with, but I wasn't able to fit it in to the realism, so the normal world, if I may call it like that. So, and now just using this completely different visual language, I feel like it doesn't matter anymore. I can so much more make it my own. And I guess it's something I knew where it's like, for me, art that I like. I mean, it's almost those two different things, no? The skill you have as an artist, on one hand, the technique, and on the other hand, what you are trying to say as an artist. So I like to look inside somebody else's head, you know. So if I see Bacon's work, it's literally that. It's even that in a brutal sense. I've been for a long time doing the technique, trying to get to a level with that, I guess. So I started pretty late with giving myself the freedom to just completely let go again and see where it's going to go. And that, I guess that's what I'm doing now. So I have no idea where it's going to go. But I feel much more that the works are becoming much more emotional. And I guess they're starting to communicate a completely different narrative. So, yeah.
I mean, this sounds very much like sort of a Taoist perspective of just letting go. And do you feel that before that you were hyper-technical and meticulous about things inside and outside of your art practice? And now that you're maturing into this new phase of your art practice, do you find yourself actually letting go of things and traumas of the past as well? Do you find that there's like a cross-pollination between the two?
Yeah, totally. Yeah, and I think it's been that as well, trying to control things. And even I've been censoring a lot of stuff in my work as well. I mean, a pretty good example of literally censoring would be, I have this series of erotic drawings that I made, and I haven't really shared them much with people because doing that for me was important, but I also realized doing that I did care a lot what people actually think about my work. So I don't know. It was pretty tough even to find that out, that so much of that, because you think like I'm a free mind. I create what I feel that I want to, but it's somehow it wasn't like that. So.
Yeah, I think it's also, you know, good to be aware of what sort of message you're trying to portray out to people too, you know, because I think it's never just one thing. It's a very complicated sort of thing, being able to express yourself and create artwork, and also understanding how other people will view it if you care about that thing. I think the best thing is to try to funnel your energy into something that feels subconscious, to where it feels like it's yeah. so just spiritually you. But first of all, I'm curious, like, what is this project that you're talking about, and why are you a bit shy to be able to put out into the world?
Well, in the first place for me, it was also an obvious thing that you just touched upon, maybe in a different sense just now. It's like, obviously, I'm also working professionally as an artist, so I sort of set out this narrative of my work, both in what it's about in substance and obviously how it's created for the galleries that I work with, and that general idea about the art world to have a certain consistency of what you're doing. So in that sense, I don't feel the need to share everything at all. To share everything I make. But with this, it was pretty, I was very conscious of it, that I felt to be even more careful about it. So I felt that I was even censoring myself. It was interesting because I draw and I paint mostly people that I know. And at some point I was talking to some people, some of my friends and even people I met on the internet that started giving me images to sketch with, or you don't always have access to a live model every day. So it's great. I like to start out in the morning and sketch some things. And some people were giving me pretty intense photos. And I mean, even of erotic nature and some extreme poses. And that just turned into a series where I was fascinated by what people, how people see themselves and how they share that with you. And it's a different thing, obviously, if I, as an artist, have the total decision of how I would depict someone that's in front of me, or that you let somebody be part of that and what they give you as input for a piece. Mm-hmm. So I know that, I think that was the basis for kind of a series like that. I even had the idea at some point to maybe turn it into a book. So it became this thing on itself that made me conscious about, wow, is this something I should do or should put out? No? So, mm-hmm. yeah.
Yeah, and you and John Wentz touched upon this as well, just that particular series.
I remember. Yeah,
it's interesting that, you know, you guys were talking about that, and just the idea between the juxtaposition, or the dividing line rather, of where, you know, like sort of like tasteful nudes or those sort of things turn into pornography, and how there's like a dividing line between what is considered art and what is considered pornography. And you both were talking about, you know, if you found an image of some naked person on the ground, then you would potentially categorize that depending on, you know, maybe the lighting or the context and everything, if it's pornography. But if you found an image of like a drawing on the ground that is potentially like the from the same reference image, that it would be perceived in a totally different way, right?
Yeah.
I'm curious, like, what's your take on that? Like, what is the dividing line for you?
Well, what I feel now, and that's what I feel enabled with now, is that with this new direction that I'm taking, I'm able to sort of incorporate that. So it's not, because now it's also how I'm I'm explaining to you. So it's like different projects, right? But I want this to be one universe, rather. Mm-hmm. So with this new direction I'm taking, I feel I could have those elements also be part of this new work. So instead of it just being something separate, and maybe that is also to do for me personally with that part, that realistic part, no? Because if you can express, if I can express myself to sort of charge that figure in that painting with a certain emotion, instead of, you know, if you see a realistic drawing, especially of a nude, it's just the way people look, I guess, or are used to look. They will, you start to look at if everything is, you know, the way it looks, you would see if it's in front of you or from a photo. And I guess if it's in a more abstract piece, different emotions or different senses are triggered in your body. So that's what I at least experience as when I look at art. So I guess it also gives you the opportunity to reach something different or to to tell something different.
I'm curious to see what your new art looks like, and I guess you'll show everyone when it's ready.
Yeah. I should have sent you some of it though.
Oh, it's okay. It's interesting that you also don't send it to me too, because now we're having to describe this this thing that I have no reference for. I think that's what's interesting about talking about visual art in general, especially if you haven't seen it and you're just listening to the description of it. And it's kind of a strange microcosm of just thought in general.
I think it's something that I totally avoided for a long time in my life as well.
Talking about your art?
Yeah, well, no, or talking about art in general and even reading about it. It's something I love doing now, but I guess I didn't do that for a long time. I mean, did you in school, or was it something that was very important, even at the time when you started with art? Or,
I mean, in terms of like analyzing it, or what do you mean?
Yeah, more the theoretical part of what we're doing, I guess. I mean, I wouldn't deny it, because obviously you build upon something that other people did before, and I was aware of that I couldn't do something new or something or start somewhere else, but I guess it took me a while to be to really catch up and be fascinated by the ideas behind it, so the real theoretical part.
For me, I've always been a very intuitive and feelings-oriented person, and I would never read instructions or...
Yeah, right.
A lot of my learning came from observations, and then taking those observations and then doing experiments. And I was never really interested in theoretical things. That's just kind of the way that I personally intake.
Yeah.
I mean, I wouldn't say never interested in theoretical things, but my first initial thing is just to do it and to dissect later. But that's just...
Yeah, no, totally. No, I'm like that. I guess that's the best way to reinvent it, no? To just, like, first have your own goal, and then... I mean, that's where you're going to end up somewhere else, right? And reading those instructions. No, totally, yeah.
Yeah. Well, let's see. I have one more question for you. Do you have any advice for artists and creatives out there? It could be any advice at all.
I have some small advice, I guess. I mean, we were just talking about Dina. To keep on going. So to really create and maybe not even think too much about what you created, but just start a new piece. I think that's a really important thing. And second thing that I found super important things don't really happen overnight. So everything's like super small steps, and those all added up at some point will mean something really important. Because in the beginning, I could be very frustrated by why is something not happening to me, or other people are moving ahead or selling work or what, of whatever nature it would be. But it's really because you have to go through those steps, and it's literally that, just a lot of small steps, but those added up will just bring you to great places and definitely where you want to be.
Yeah. Mm. Bring it back to your conversation with John Wentz. I also thought it was really interesting that you two were talking about the practice of creating art, and how John was saying that he would spend 2 hours a day drawing, or an hour a day drawing, and then there was a point where he hit 3 hours a day, and then 4 hours and 5 hours, and then he was just tapped in. And yeah, I think that's something that a lot of people have to be aware of too, is that it's literally like training. It's almost like trying to build muscle, but you're building muscle in art, and you're trying to ingrain this habit. And I think that's what's really important during these particular times, especially, is to already have those habits in place, or learn and create new habits for yourself that will help you in the future.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, instead of just going into this like existential dread, self-loathing sort of consciousness, to be able to step back and empower yourself by saying, no, I'm going to actually take this time to reinvent myself. I think that's super important, especially during a time when there's so much uncertainty and so much media drama and all of this out there and negativity. I think you can turn that negativity into gold if you apply yourself in that way and in that mental capacity.
Yeah, totally. I think it's difficult for people because, you know, a lot of people right now, they're thrown back onto themselves almost literally, you know, in a small house or room somewhere. But I think if you are somehow able to do that, that's super valuable. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's a very complicated thing. There's never been a global pandemic. I believe there hasn't been one since like the 1920s.
No. It's incredible.
Yeah. It is complicated, but it's also very simple at the same time, what you can do to change your mindset. And I think that applies to a lot of things in life. Just things that we think are extremely complicated actually can be very simple if we just look at it in a different way. And that's just kind of something that I've been thinking about during this time period. But what about you? What have you been thinking about during this time period?
Well, I've had a few conversations with John Wentz about it as well. And it's funny, Daniel Martin is in, we share a studio.
Yeah.
He did the podcast with you, obviously, as well.
Yeah, I like Daniel.
Yeah, he's super cool.
Definitely.
His energy is amazing. Anyway, mm-hmm. When I first talked to him, I was in Spain doing another residency, and he was still in Mexico, and this whole crisis broke out. And he's normally very, like, this optimistic mind flying around everywhere and, you know, chasing big dreams. And so am I, but he can be so high up there. But the first thing he said to me was like, okay, so the next 100 years, we're not going to sell any art anymore. So what are we going to do? And I was like, wow, okay. That sounds very depressing. But it was obviously, knowing Daniel, a joke as well. But we've been thinking about a lot of stuff, you know. Also, obviously, in other jobs, people are embracing the digital because they have to, you know, to even have a meeting, of course. But so, yeah, what can we do in that space with art? And John is totally fascinated with that as well. I'm super excited to see all the stuff he's been doing lately with digital paint. But I guess I have to be careful not to start too many things. I get a lot of ideas. I mean, like I said before, in a way, this is a good place for me. It's not that I like it, but it triggers so much in my feelings and in my mind. But I've done that in my life as well. So many different things I have touched upon. And in a way, it's great. I mean, I worked in film and 3D animation and in design. And I can use all those skills now with what I do in art. But I also feel I have to really focus. So what you're just saying now about going back to yourself and maybe focus on something very basic that's very close to you, I think that's a good idea. And I think that's definitely what I'm trying to do, but what I should do even more, to pick something out of this and take that one step further.
Yeah.
I think that's maybe another answer to your previous question, why art? I was doing a lot of things, and then I decided, okay, I just really want to excel at something. So, and then I picked this out of a few options for many reasons. But yeah, you can only do so much, no, within the given time that we have. So,
well, I have a couple thoughts on that. I think having an art practice right now and having a contemplative practice in general is extremely important. Being able to gestate new ideas during this time period will help push the world forward in hopefully positive ways. And I think it's the job of artists and creatives to be able to shine some light on that and to give people some hope after such an uncertain time period.
Yeah, man, it's interesting because in so many ways, it's so, for me, becoming so clear what the importance is of art in these times.
Yes.
I think you're really spot on that one. Even on so many, you know, I think it was this funny thing that came by on Instagram, but somebody said, so you think culture wasn't important, so what are you going to do now without your books, your music, your movies? And that's a very obvious one, of course, but some art I've been looking at from artists that I admire for so long, looking at them now, seeing what they suddenly mean for me personally. I don't know. I feel art at this moment much more intense than I used to. And I feel that as a total enrichment, you know, that I don't know. I was looking at so much stuff and even in museums and just, you know, not really taking the time to sometimes let something sink in, but somehow I'm pushed back to that or something.
Yeah.
Things seem to slow down and everything's coming in so much more charged, so much more emotional. So yeah, so much more intense.
Do you think that you've been able to concentrate during this time period and find some clarity?
It's funny. I was thinking about that before we had the interview now. Because I had a very good week last week, and this week is sort of definitely a dip in there. So I was like, oh, wow, is this really a great time to do a podcast? But then I was like, well, yeah, maybe it is too. I think it's anyway interesting, you know, like I said before, I'm transforming. And so that's a fragile moment. I don't know. Maybe it's good to share that with people, you know, instead of telling a really solid story of, you know, this is who I am, this is where I am, and this is where I'm going. So, no, it's really going up and down. So I had a really good week, and this week it's kind of very hard to focus and keep a structure. I try to have a very clear structure for the day. That's something that I need, and it helps me a lot in many ways. But it's totally going off this week somehow.
Yeah, I think that's, you know, I think that's fine. That's just kind of the emotional side and emotional state of just being human. And to be able to share that with other people, I think can be comforting to a lot of people, because life is not always about the ups, whether it's in a relationship or whether it's with your art practice or with what you do for work. And this is what I was trying to get at before, was that I think a lot of people are addicted to highs and addicted to ups. And because of that, for instance, let's just paint this picture and say that you're working a corporate job and every weekend or potentially every night you're going and doing copious amounts of drugs and drinking copious amounts of alcohol. And there's some psychosis within that, that you're ingraining this sort of sense of addiction to, well, first of all, substances, but also just addiction to highs and addiction to ups. So when you're challenged with a period like this, where you can't go out anymore, you're forced to be quarantined in your house, then I think there's a lot of societal things that are starting, there's like societal unrest now because of those things. And I think like the more that you hide from yourself, the more that it's going to do detrimental damage to you in the long term. And I think a lot of people are just addicted to just getting those highs and not analyzing the lows. And the lows tell you more about yourself than the highs.
That's interesting, man. I never thought about it like that.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, this is just things that I've been, I have this practice of writing, and I write almost every single day, and just trying to be honest and understand. Like, I feel like just sometimes people can be mysteries to themselves if they don't understand the certain things that they process or don't even process it, you know?
Yeah, totally.
Right. Totally. So
I guess writing is a very great tool for that. Yeah. Yeah. I heard in your previous podcast that you are writing. Yeah. That's amazing.
Yeah. Yeah. But I think, you know, it's just, I encourage a lot of people to have a writing practice, even if it's just a journal or writing just a little bit a day, because it really helps you to be able to like dissect the things that you think about and to be honest with it. And you don't have to show it to anyone. You can just literally just have it for yourself.
Yeah. Especially if you manage to do that daily, I think that's great. And it's also, I mean, something that's been going last couple of years, it started, I don't know why, my memory is becoming terrible.
Mine too.
And then I found this, yeah, so maybe it's an age thing.
Yeah, yeah. Hopefully not. We're still relatively young.
Yeah. Thanks. I found some sketchbooks from like 10 years ago. And I was like, shit, you know, there's like little marks in there, or a few lines or some ideas roughly or just minimally put down. And I was like, I wish, you know, that I wrote down a bit more, because now I can read it back. And I don't know, I would have loved to know what I was thinking then. So it's great for that as well. It's sort of time traveling, I guess.
It's really interesting to be able to analyze your past, because in the present, you are currently living the present and creating memories as you go along. And how it's interesting, you know, you're talking about just this idea that, you know, you forget certain things. And I think memories can become illusions almost, because it's sprinkled with our subjectivity of the infallibility of being human. And our memories deceive us at times. So to be able to write something down. Yeah. Go on. Sorry.
No, you were talking about memories. I consider them one of the weirdest concepts around. I almost see them as objects. So it's like, and they function like you're saying. Yeah. So if you see them as an object, at some point they're pretty clear, but over time they start to take different shapes or even different dimensions or forms. So talking about reality, that's fascinating.
Mm-hmm. Well, Dan, seriously, thanks so much for taking the time to do this conversation. And I really value you for, you know, taking this time and being vulnerable and, you know, sharing your insights. And I think a lot of people will really enjoy this.
Thanks, man. I really enjoyed it. And thanks for the conversation. I mean, it was great to exchange, and nice getting to know you a bit.
Yeah, thanks again, man. And cool. Well, I guess I'll talk to you later.
Have a good day there, man.
All right. Cool. I'll talk to you later.
Okay. Talk to you later. Bye.